I'm Tim Urban, and some people would consider me heretical because I am down to get out of my biological body. I will put machines in my brain. I will upload my consciousness, whatever. Doesn't sound that great being a dying mammal to me.
Radicals, dissidents, rebels, and misfits. You can call them whatever you like, but what if they're right?
A generation or two down the road, many or most humans on Earth might have an interface in under their skull, in their brain, that allows them to connect their brain to the outside world. And that's a concept that a lot of people are extremely uncomfortable with, for the same reason probably that people were uncomfortable with organ transplants when they first became a new technology. The concept of transhumanism, the kind of enhancing a human in a way that couldn't have been done to a caveman. I think that's actually not a black and white thing. I think it happens gradually. Every generation, we become a little more transhuman. And if you look back, every generation, there's a huge amount of resistance to it. If you say to people, you know, do you think it's good if humans become cyborgs? Many people will say no. But what's a cyborg? It's a person that has also tech capabilities. If I want to talk to you, I can talk to you in person. We can talk from 10 feet away. Or I can talk to you when you're on the other side of the planet and we can talk with FaceTime. That is a cyborg capability. The thing that we might say, what would actually make us an official cyborg is if the phone were on the other side of our skin. We're actually in our head. But is that a meaningful thing? To me, what side of the skull the tech is on is not a big deal. The fact is, these are both cyborgs. The person holding the phone against their head is kind of a low-grade cyborg. The one with the phone capability inside their head is just a more advanced cyborg. We're already cyborgs, so let's go for it. Let's just become the best cyborgs we can. When people hear about brain-machine interfaces, they think it's icky. But we have pacemakers. That's a machine. We have deep brain stimulation currently for Parkinson's patients. People who are hearing impaired use cochlear implants. That's a brain-machine interface. So we are already in a world of brain-machine interfaces, and they're just very primitive. Right now, thoughts from my head are going into your head as the viewer of this. And that's pretty cool, but what we're not really thinking about is how much information is lost in that transfer. When we're speaking sentences, we're always giving very crude, compressed approximations of much higher res, larger files, you know, nuanced thoughts. And with brain-machine interfaces, forget words. Well, why would we need to compress anymore? Just send the nuanced thought. Elon Musk calls it conceptual telepathy. You're not saying words in my head. You can do that, but why? Just think to me. I think with practice, we could all get good at this. And then you think about the possibilities. It doesn't just have to be me communicating a concept to you. We can have five of us together having a joint brainstorm. We've actually formed kind of a super brain and we're just thinking together. And we might come up with an incredible epiphany that none of us could have come up with alone. There's a lot of scary emergent properties of humans. You know, look at Twitter today. Just like we have the ability to form, you know, larger groups for creativity, for collaboration, groups that the core emotion is love, which is great. We have abilities to form groups where the core emotion is hate, where a group is bound by a common enemy, by the dehumanization of a common enemy, by common bigotry. This is very common. You could say the internet did a godsend for individuality, for good ideas to spread. It also did wonders for mob rule. And I think brain-machine interfaces, we will probably have some amazing things that come out of it. And also, there will be a lot of people getting indoctrinated into some bad ideas in a very much more intense way. I would still say most of us probably wouldn't give up the internet and go back to that planet. And if you go live in 1990 for 2 weeks and tell me you want to stay there and you don't want to come back to the world that we live in now, you probably would like to be here. I think we need to reconsider this assumption that natural is good and artificial is bad, because your clothes are not natural, your home is not natural, the heating in your home is not natural, your car is not natural. So I think the boundary we think there is between natural and artificial is actually kind of a total construct that's not real, and that we should embrace the kind of species we are, which is something that builds a lot of tools of all different kinds. Beavers build dams, and humans do 100,000 examples of that. And we're just super beavers that use a million different kinds of things, not just dams. Beavers have one hack. We have a million. Yeah, we're super beavers.
Yeah, that's the name of my softball team.